same kind of urgency to complete a critique of Practical Reason as there was to present a critique of speculative or theoretical reason. So the critique of pure reason was primarily that. And that's because, as I explained last time, theoretical reason is driven to ask certain questions that it cannot itself answer about traditional metaphysical objects, for example, and is therefore tends to overextend itself and drive itself into contradiction, asking where is God, for example, where physically, where space is God. In contrast to that, those kinds of problems that theoretical reason gets itself into, practical reason, Kant thinks, doesn't. And he thinks that common sense morality, our ordinary moral sense, what we all know is right and wrong, is a pretty good guide to pure practical reason. So let me say that again. Kant thinks that our ordinary common sense knowledge of morality is a pretty good guide to pure practical reason. But as I said, we are imperfectly rational beings. So we're tempted by our desires, we're tempted by our empirical desires, which often may conflict with the requirements of practical reason, which often may conflict with the requirements of morality. And Kant is quite optimistic that we can recognize that. Kant is, in fact, extremely optimistic that we all know what morality requires of us. He thinks it's perfect, just consult your conscience. That's a pretty darn good guide to what morality requires. He says that every human being, even the worst scoundrel, knows what morality requires. Everyone has a conscience that's pretty accurate. So he's pretty optimistic about that. On the other hand, he's actually pretty pessimistic about human willingness to act on moral principles. So he thinks that we all know what morality requires. He's really confident about that. He thinks it's obvious what morality requires. But mostly we don't do what's required of us. Most of us is pretty pessimistic about our tendency to act on what we know to be right. Okay. So just to emphasize this last point one more time, he says, despite the kind of horrifying title, the he says intimidating title, he thinks that this can serve as an investigation into this pure principle that will be helpful. And he notes that he's leaving out the empirical part, he's leaving out the anthropology, and so he's going to be talking very little about applications of the fundamental principle to human beings. We do actually get more of that in the Metaphysics and Morals later on. And so, very bottom of the page, last paragraph on page 7, 392. The present groundwork, however, is nothing more than the identification and corroboration of the supreme principle of morality. So what this groundwork is, despite all those other components, the empirical components that I've been talking about, this is a very limited investigation, an investigation into simply the pure part of morality, the fundamental principle of morality. So, while there are going to be a very few illustrations of what the principle requires and how it's going to be applied, he says he's going to try to avoid that because that will distract us from the purity of this first principle. So instead, we're going to proceed this way. In the first part, one, we're going to work from our common sense understanding of morality, which remember he thinks is pretty accurate, that we all have a conscience, which is a pretty accurate guide to what morality requires. And we're going to analyze that common sense morality in order to work toward the formulation of the supreme principle of morality. So we're going to assume that we all pretty much know what's right and wrong, what morality requires, and try to analyze that common sense moral understanding to try to identify the supreme principle of morality sort of buried in our conscience. And so this is called the transition from common sense to philosophical, moral, rational cognition. The second part, chapter part, is called transition from popular moral philosophy to metaphysics of morals. Now what he calls popular moral philosophy is not what I just described as common sense judgments. So what Kant thinks is that our common sense judgments, our ordinary moral sense, our ordinary conscience, is a pretty good guide to what morality requires. But our common understanding of its underpinnings is poor. He thinks our common, like, ordinary metaphysical picture of these things is not good, because it tends to be empirical. We tend not to realize that there must be a pure part in order to get the necessity that our common sense thinks is there. So here he's arguing against that. And in this section, what he's doing is basically analyzing the idea of a will, autonomous will or pure will, to come up with, once again, the same supreme principle of morality that we saw in the first part. So the first part, we work from our common sense moral judgments to try to identify the supreme principle of morality. In part two, we work from the idea of a will or a pure will to try to come up with that same principle of morality. And we wind up showing how this supreme principle of morality is grounded in the idea of autonomy, in the idea of a will that can give itself laws. Okay, and notice that in these first two chapters, these first two parts, Kant does not attempt to show that the principle, that the supreme principle of morality, applies to us human beings. In the first section, we're proceeding analytically from the common sense idea of morality. In the second section, we proceed analytically from the idea of a will that acts according to principles of pure practical reason. And the third chapter, then, is called the final step from the metaphysics of morals to the critique of pure practical reason. And here he's interested finally in considering how we might establish that the principles of pure practical reason, the supreme principle of morality, in fact applies to us human beings. That is, how we can know, or whether we can know, that we in fact have one of these wills that can give itself laws, practical laws. So really part three is considering what kind of justification we can give for that assumption that we have the kind of will that principles of pure practical reason apply to. After all, we're not pure wills. We're sometimes moved by inclinations. So part three, he wants to find some kind of warrant for thinking that we are autonomous. And this cannot be done simply by analyzing the ideas of practical reason or analyzing the ideas of morality. This is a synthetic idea. This is bringing together two distinct ideas, the idea of a human being and the idea of an autonomous will, and yet we need to find some way of justifying this a priori. So this is another one of those synthetic, substantive, a priori claims, just like mathematical claims, except that this is involving practical reason rather than theoretical reason. And once that's been done, then we will have vindicated the idea that the supreme principle of morality does apply to us. So Kant's justification for thinking of ourselves in this way, thinking of ourselves as autonomous, as having a will that can give ourselves laws, is of course going to be limited. Obviously, we're not going to get anything like a scientific proof. This is not an empirical fact about us. This is not something that can be established through theoretical reason. The most that we can get, the most vindication we can get of this idea, is that from a practical point of view, what I said last time, from a deliberative point of view, we assume this stance that we have a will, and theoretical reason can't refute it. So this is the best that we can do, that we can't refute the idea of our having an autonomous will from a scientific point of view. And it's a practical presupposition of our deliberation. So that doesn't prove that there is such a thing. Prove that we do in fact have such a will. It just makes room for the possibility. And then for practical purposes, from a deliberative point of view, it's a presupposition. Okay, I wanted to say something about part one, but I think I'll stop here. On Friday, we'll get started talking about part one. This idea of improving growth as the starting point. Okay, so if you haven't done so, finish part one and we'll start talking about